Hello and welcome back to GM32. I'm Vito Scringy.
I'm Carson Johnstone. I'm going to address the big ugly elephant in the room right away. We started off the GM35 podcast. Those of you that are with us from the beginning, you'll know. It's been one episode and yeah, I made a mistake. The code we explained last episode for GM35, third, fourth, fifth man in, unfortunately is actually GM32. So
yeah, GM35, I do believe, is a player coming off the bench. I did have one of my ref buddies come and message me about that. And you know what? Thanks for tuning in and giving us a little helping hand there. We appreciate that, and we do apologize. A little mishap.
But brain fart, actually. You know what? I'll take full responsibility because I looked it up, and I remember thinking, actually, I wish it was GM35 because I like the sound of it.
That's what you thought, eh?
I think it's stuck with me. And that's just how she goes. But you know what? We're happy with GM32.
Hey, welcome to GM32, everybody.
Welcome to GM32.
And we got, you know what, Carson? We got a good episode tonight, I think, too. You know what I mean? We got a couple young studs coming on tonight. Just young beauties.
Yeah, we got Daylon Groulx and Kurtis Henry, two, OHL guys coming into their last year or coming out of their last year, you know, with this COVID stuff. Going to be some interesting stuff. We're going to talk about their journey there, some other things.
You know what? I'm excited to talk about the jumps they made, you know what I mean? And, some of the, like I said, I'm into the war stories. I'm into those battle stories. And I know my buddy Kurt Henry's got a couple of them. So I can't wait to hear about those. And
yeah, he doesn't mind chucking them.
No, he's not the smallest character out there either, right?
Yeah, so. And I remember Daylon when I was, 19, 20 years old playing in Fort Erie. He was coming out as a 12, 13-year-old. He's a Fort Erie guy and just ripping apart our goalies then. So, I'm excited to talk to these guys. It's going to be great.
It's going to be a hell of a show. I hope you guys enjoy it. And, stay tuned. Welcome back, boys. Welcome to GM32. I'm Vito Scringy here with my buddy
Carson Johnstone here. We're here with Kurt Henry and Daylon.
How do you pronounce your last name, man? I can't get it. And I gotta try Groulx. Let's hear it.
Yeah, well, it's actually French, but Groulx.
Oh, beauty.
But I get it both ways.
Yeah, whatever lot, it
so
is.
It doesn't matter.
Welcome, boys. How are you? How you guys doing?
Good. Everything's been good so far, so thanks for having us on, eh?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for coming on, boys. We got a stellar show coming up today, and we're going to have some good stories with these guys. Boys, I'm going to start with you, Kurt. Kurt, your hometown Niagara Falls, boy, I appreciate that very much. Good hometown kid. Let's hear how you started. When did you first pick up a stick here?
Probably back when I was like 3 years old. I started playing. My dad got me in skates pretty quickly, actually, so pretty much as soon as I could walk, maybe even when I was two. So I've been at it a long time now, just playing in locally here in Niagara Falls. So it's been good.
So actually, I'm going to interject here quick. So as you guys are over 20, right, this year?
Yeah.
COVID obviously put a damper on the final year for you guys, right? That was tough. So obviously now you played a few years in the O and through junior and that too. So, we want to discuss that too. And Kurt, you're talking about starting young and that and growing up and playing for the Canucks. So what was that like, just in minor hockey and that and Daylon, you in Fort Erie and stuff. So what was that like for you guys? Is it just the experience growing up to that?
Yeah, it was awesome. It was great playing locally. I always loved it. We always had pretty good teams. I played with Day a lot actually growing up. So we have some good stories from back then. We had great times. We got really close with the boys from Niagara. So it was a great time.
Yeah, it was good. Obviously, me growing up in Fort Erie, too, I started off playing single A here in town. And obviously, it's a lot smaller town than Niagara Falls. And you get to know a lot of people. And it's nice to, when I was 16, I got to play junior B in Fort Erie my first year. With all the boys that I kind of grew up with, and that was nice to be able to represent my hometown again. Playing with Kurt growing up, we've been buddies since we were learning how to skate probably too. So
you guys had a pretty stellar team growing up, eh?
Yeah.
Now, did you guys end up making the move to when Niagara, were you guys still playing minor hockey when Niagara Falls dropped down to Double A?
Yeah, we were.
And then you guys make the jump too.
We went to Southern Tier.
You guys both went to Southern Tier?
Yeah.
And you guys had a gross team, right? Like you guys were.
Yeah, we were amalgamated.
Pretty good, yeah, we were usually pretty good. Yeah. We'd make it to OMHAs.
Yeah, that's nasty. Good. That's good.
That's awesome. Now, like I said too, so, you know, that's great playing for your hometown, and then moving into the OHL, like, what was that like getting drafted and stuff, you know, like, you guys both were drafted, correct?
Yeah.
So what's that like, you know, for a lot of guys don't know what that feels like, they wish to be drafted, I don't know what it's like, you know, I didn't get drafted. But, you know, tell us about that and just that experience.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. Obviously, growing up your whole life, it's a dream to be drafted, and obviously it's a big day. And I was lucky enough to be drafted, but it just goes with all the hours of work I put in, and it kind of pays off, I guess. And yeah, it's awesome. It's a great feeling, and I had a good opportunity to play in Owen Sound in Ottawa, two pretty good organizations. So it was a good 4 years and probably the most fun of my life.
Yeah, you're never gonna get those times back. You know what I mean? Those are some dynamite times, but now that you're speaking of that day, sorry, but what are your plans coming on for, like, the rest of the season nowadays? Because I know you just said you were across over in, I believe you were in Austria, right?
Yeah.
So, like, how was that, because you still got a year of junior left, how was that jump? That's kind of a quick jump. How do you feel about going from juniors, getting drafted or whatnot, playing 4 years in the O, then boom, to a quick pro league?
Yeah, it was a big transition, obviously, going from playing guys that are 16 to 20 years old and then making the jump to 30-year-old, 35-year-old men that have families and they're driving their kids to school every morning. It's definitely a lot different.
It's astonishing to me how you did that, man. I respect that huge. You know, just the work ethic you have. Like, I play with you on the pond all the time. Like we're always out there. We're having a great time. Speaking of the pond.
Yeah, let's hear this story. Okay, you know, let me ask the story because I heard about it.
Can I cut you off real quick? Yeah. Sorry, I got this whole V in my hand that needs to be cracked. I'm just going to be... Oh, there it is. A little salute, boys. A little cheers, boys. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, no problem.
But, and then, Karis, go ahead. Yeah, sorry to cut you off there, bud.
So, I heard about this pond story with our buddy Shitty Bill. I heard you guys were playing and, you know, it was game 7 and, you were going pretty hard and you're, you know, just embarrassing yourself out there. That's what I heard. That's a story I heard. So tell us, let's clear that up for the listeners.
I gotta hear it. I was there, but I like to recap it. Let's go.
Yeah. So, shout out to Shitty Bill. Yeah, you know, I think, we were over at his house, his pond kind of thing. So he had the home court kind of vibes and I think he just really wanted to get that game winner. And, you know, I just kind of caught him on the back check there, gave him a quick little 2-inch stick lift, and then it was gone the other way from there. A goal about a foot off the ice, and then next thing I know, the net was tipped over.
It was a foot off the ice? Yeah. I thought you buzzed one.
No, no, it was pretty low.
He buzzed one earlier.
He buzzed one earlier? Goal, yeah. Oh, you hit the goalie right in the head.
Yeah.
That's it. Should have just pissed at that.
If you don't want to get hit, though, like, don't go net, right?
You know what? Butterfly goalies, too, your head's under the crossbar when you go down. What do you expect?
You know what?
I'm on the shooter's side here.
You know what? All
your job is to save it, though.
All in all, the boys just want to win a game. You know what I mean?
I got a question for goalies out there. Is it your job to stop most pucks or every puck? And you can respond with your answer. But anyways, that's a hilarious story. I'm glad we cleared that up.
That's phenomenal.
Yeah, but anyway, we ended up winning, so.
Oh, we did. I was on the 2-1.
Vito was on the team,
too. Yeah,
it
was a beauty. I'll take the plus.
Did you just pack it in after that?
Yeah,
I had a stick whiz by my ears. Shitty helicoptered one over my head and then threw the net a bit. But it's all right. Classic. We're good.
All in good. All in fair game, though. You know, I think the boys just like winning. And you know what? To be honest, Dave? We took the dub that day, and I appreciate that. Great nip.
Well, is that the house going on right now? It's getting competitive out of the ponds. But we got to get back and hear Kurt's story here. We were talking about the OHL draft experience and going through that and what that was like in their careers. So let's hear about that.
Yeah, draft day was awesome. You know, having a team believe in you and draft you makes you feel good about yourself and gives you a lot of confidence. Makes you want to work hard for that team. Show them that they didn't mess up when they drafted you. So. Yeah, it was a great experience. Kind of gave me a lot of motivation to keep working hard, you know. Just made me want to make the team. So that's where it ultimately comes down to, hard work, and how hard you work is if you make the team or not.
Did it feel cool, you know, playing for a guy like Wes Wolf, a local guy, you know, in the Erie organization that had to feel comfortable, you know, knowing a guy in the organization and someone that felt confident in you?
Yeah, I wasn't too close with Wes before, but I knew he was a local guy. I knew who he was. Obviously, he probably knew who I was, but Wes is a great guy. I've got a good relationship with him now just over my time in Erie. He's a good coach, you know. He's close with the players. He knows how to treat them. So
great suit collection too.
Yeah. Oh, and the hats that dressed. Guy got. Yeah, oh, easily best dressed in the all.
He's yeah. been yeah. the best dressed. Sorry, yep. best dressed since he played junior C for the Riverhawks. Honest to God, he's
don't
had
make
a different
his head
suit.
Any bigger.
Hey, but you kind of have to. That guy's a Riverhawk legend.
Yeah, he is.
Like, oh my God, hang his jersey, hang the guy's jersey, retire
Wolfie.
The number.
Wolfie.
Jeez.
All right,
boys, Kurt. I'm gonna bust this out, man. I was once we realized you were coming on the show, once we caught you down there, I jumped on Hockey Fights and I looked you up a couple times. Buddy, you didn't lose too much. I don't think you lost one. I looked at like how's it? Does it like as a 16-year-old? You went out there and you wanted to chuck them too, like with the Canucks, and then as a rookie with Erie, you weren't scared out there. How'd it feel just to step out? How was your first fight? Let's hear the first fight story here.
Yeah, my first one was in Junior B when I was playing for the Canucks. Oh, yeah. We had a game in Caledonia, and I think my one buddy fought for her. I think my one other buddy fought first, and he did all right in the fight, and then it was just a rough game, and then I ended up fighting, and then after the fight, it was just such a big rush. I just, like, wanted to do it so many
You're
times.
You jacked up,
yeah,
man. Did you do well in it, too?
Yeah, I did pretty good. Just, like, punches, and we fell to the ground, and then he maybe threw one, and then it was over. But yeah, it was a great feeling.
Was that would that have been like your first ever hockey fight? Could you say did you fight minor hockey a couple times?
We get in brawls in minor hockey. Yeah, you guys. It was more like the just bucket box and punch each other in the cage.
Yeah, for sure. This was actually
visors, like that's beautiful. Gloves off. You always see it on TV growing up, so you're always excited.
And then you got it in and the then, best.
Yeah,
that's what I told everyone. The best way to learn is just to go out and do it. Yeah. That's the best way I learned.
That's funny.
Yeah,
you say your first fight is against Caledonia. Just kind of reminded me when I came home when I was playing in college. I came home and watched a game, just happened to go watch Fort Erie play against Caledonia, and you were playing as an AP, your first ever game against Caledonia. And it's funny now, sitting here, just kind of jog my memory. You said fighting against Caledonia, and I thought, like, wasn't he playing for Fort Erie? So you actually did play for Fort Erie, too.
Yeah, when I was 15, I played a game, yeah. I think they played a game, too.
Wow, do we all have alumni teams. In us right now? We have four Fort Erie Meteor alumni in here.
Four Meteors.
Wow, that's incredible.
Yeah.
That's incredible. Awesome. I had a lot of good battles against Caledonia, too. That's a stellar team. And you know what? I'm going to have to bring it up right now. Let's let's pour
cheers
one out.
To
let's cheers and pour one out to Kenny Hill. Great owner, great man. Yeah. Put a lot of winning teams together. He did a lot of good things. Loved the Gulch, loved hockey. And God rest your soul, sir. Let's get back into the moment, though, here.
Back into the OHL career, sir, boys. Like we said, Daylon, you had a little bit of experience. But, you know, moving forward, what's the plan here, fellas? Like, well, I guess we can start with you, Kurt. We've heard a lot from Daylon. He can shut his mouth for a little while.
Yeah, so I was hoping to play my last year in Erie, last year in the Oaks. It's my OA year, but hoping to get a look, maybe pro or go play for schools, maybe in U Sports. That's always good hockey. It's a good option. If the right pro contract doesn't come around, then that'd probably be the way I'd go. But right now I'm just hoping that they can figure out a way to safely get back to playing and have a season, whether it be like the 24 games that they're saying. Hopefully they have that and I get a shot to play and see where I go from there.
Yeah,
you get a good look, eh? It's your last year, man. Yeah. Like it's tough. But let's hear you. Let's get a little breakdown. What's the bubble look like for you right now? Do you have any idea?
I've been here in Hub City, so four Hub cities, five teams of Hub City.
Okay.
But
you play 24 games.
24 games. I'm not 100% sure about playoffs or not. Okay. I think they probably have something maybe condensed.
I would assume. Total assumption. I would assume they're trying to get some sort of a season in so they don't have to sacrifice the draft and give some of these kids an opportunity, right?
Yeah.
You know, I don't know what that looks like for 20-year-olds either, but for you guys, like, hopefully they don't sacrifice that either because, you know, that's special to you guys too. So it's going to be a difficult situation either way, but just because, you know, some of the new guys that got drafted too haven't had that chance. So it'll be interesting to see.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I've been here in April 2nd is when they're trying to get it started.
Nice. Now, like, if they were to fully cancel a season, I did hear, I think I was watching TSN or something, and I did hear that they were going to do, if it got completely scratched, they were going to do a double draft next year and completely skip the draft this year. Would that entitle you guys to, would that give you another, like, an OA year, you think? Have you heard any word about that?
I haven't heard too much about that so far, but there's been, like, some small talk with, like, some of the guys who work in hockey, and they've been saying, like, that I guess there's a possibility of that happening, but... They haven't really gone to discussions about it. So
it's just completely unfair for these kids, man. I just it's such a
virus,
tough.
The virus doesn't stop for nobody. No, it's unfair. It's unfortunately
such a battle, and
it's tough for athletes, man. And you know what, we could talk about that too till we're blue in the face, but you know, one of the big concerns that I've heard is, you know, being told we're not essential, you know, over and over as athletes, and it sucks. You know, it's tough, but man, yeah, like I said, that's a topic we could go down a rabbit hole. But anyways, Daylon, let's hear from you. You know, your plans moving forward here. You know, you had a little experience over there in Austria this year. You did well. You know, you said that was a great experience. But moving forward, what's the deal here?
Yeah, I think right now, obviously, I'm just trying to do what I can to stay in as best shape as possible and get on the ice as much as I can. And the only ice I can get on right now is at ponds. So
yeah, it is.
And no, but yeah, I think the rest of the year I'll just try to get ready for next, the start of next season, obviously back in Austria. So I'm hoping
you're heading COVID, back there for sure, right?
Yeah, that's the plan. If things with COVID get better, obviously that's why I came back home.
You signed a 2-year deal though.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
So then we'll just kind of.
It's nice to be settled at least, knowing that you know, you have that, you know, you're ready to go next year as long as they give the green light. You know, you got a lot of guys who are in that situation right now. They don't have a contract. They're sitting there, and you know, they're sitting there questioning whether to hang them up or not. It's tough. So you know, at least you got that in your back pocket to say, you know, I'm ready to play when they're ready to go. So that's good.
Yeah, for sure. They really understood and we're totally okay with my decision to kind of come home, and they understood that what's going on with COVID's kind of more important than hockey right now. So
it's awesome. Kurt,
how are you handling it right now? What are you doing on your spare time? I know I've been out the pond with you. We go quite often. We go 5-6 days a week almost. But other than that, what are you doing right now to kind of keep busy?
Yeah, just trying to stay in shape as much as possible. Work out when I can. Get on the ice as much as possible. Just, you know, keep playing. So hopefully, if a season does happen soon, I'll be ready to go when it's good to go. So just been trying to stay busy. It's a lot of downtime, right? Because we're used to being so busy playing hockey every day and having a packed schedule. So it's definitely an adjustment. But we've been playing some fantasy basketball and stuff.
Oh, yeah. That's beauty.
Dave's the commissioner for our hockey and basketball league.
Yeah.
The commission.
Is he pulling shady trades?
No.
No, easily. Like, don't. That no.
I,
right
no,
there
I just
like,
think.
No,
yeah, I yeah, don't. You are. I don't, but, like, I don't know. They have their opinions. So they can't blame me. I'm in second last, so I'm not doing anything anyway. Like, if I'm in first,
the guy,
then that's
the
what
guy's
you
taking
me.
Half cuts from the winner. That's
what yeah, that's better. Than
that's funny. No, but you know what, boys. Listen, you played in the OHL. That's lots of fun. We got to hear some stories about that. You got to have some memorable moments, some things that happened, coaches, some nutty guys. Come on, we got to hear it. We got to hear a couple things. Like, we don't get too racy here. We got the listeners, but we got to hear some fun ones.
Yeah, well, I remember in my first year, I was 16, and I was kind of quiet.
Schmelt.
My first year didn't really say too much. But the older guys. My one coach, he had a glass eye, and so he
that's awesome.
So he had like problems with his depth perception on like how far away things were.
Yeah, you'd see like two dimensionally, right?
Yeah. So these guys on my team, the older guys, would start flicking pucks up in the air at him, and he would be dodging them, thinking they're gonna hit him, but they're 20 feet away.
No way.
So they're going in the corner, and he's in the slot, and he's like ducking, but they're not even close to him.
Honestly, as long as they're not shooting it at him, I think that's kind of a funny prank.
No, it was pretty funny.
Did he laugh about it, or would he get mad?
Yeah, no, he did. He laughed.
Oh, that's a good guy. That's a good guy.
Good sport about it.
That's a good guy.
Yeah.
That's awesome. You know what? I can honestly say, if I had something like that, I feel like I'd be that guy that was like cheery about it and laughed about it, and you know, not one of those guys like a dick and like, oh, don't talk about it.
Yeah,
that's funny 100%. Though. But a good guy.
That's a stud move. But it's people flicking pucks, buddy. You better hear about Big Terry's rants back in the day. You just missed playing for Terry.
Yeah, I just missed him.
That's an unbelievable buddy. One of my favorite coaches ever. Best, just knew how to fire you up, knew how to get you going, knew how to put a great team together. It was unbelievable. But flicking pucks was something he was dynamite at. And this guy, if you 2-3 passes that weren't on the tape during practice, every puck on the ice was flicked up over the glass into like the standing area by the upper concession at the Gale. I would howl at this guy.
He just flick them all off the ice?
The whole, every puck. And until we'd keep doing the drill until all the pucks were gone. And like it would just be, and then he would be losing it. We would be like, I'd be howling, like, oh my god!
Some of the young guys getting scared.
The young guys just getting. When I was when I was 16, oh my god, scary as hell. But like when I was 18, 19, like this thing was, it was.
Yeah.
He did it a couple of times, and it was fucking, it was priceless, dude.
That's awesome.
It was priceless.
Yeah, Kurt, what do you got for us? You got anything?
Yeah, when we'd go in hotels, we'd do, like, pranks a lot to each other, to each other's hotel rooms and stuff. We'd get the ice bucket filled up with ice water.
Oh, yeah.
Lean it on the door, knock, and then...
Leaners are classic.
Yeah. When they open it, just soaks their room. We've even tied a bed sheet to the one guy's door and tied it across to the person.
That's a good one. I haven't heard that
and
one.
Then the guy couldn't open the door. Like, we knocked on the door and we just watched him. Like, his door was locked for a while. He couldn't get out.
That's
pretty funny.
Trying to
play. I used to love just the, even like, you know, like rookie hazing's one thing, but like throwing the, you know, as a 16-year-old, like you own up to being a rookie. You gotta own, you know your spot. You know what I mean. You kind of gotta earn your stripes a little bit. So like rookie hazing's one thing, but rookie initiate, kind of like doing the rookie deeds, I think that's a complete other thing. And like, man, where there's some funny ones. Like just like you showing up to the rink, you getting ready for practice, and having a piece of clear just on the bottom of your blades. You have no idea. You go out and you're just bailing everywhere on the ice. Guys are howling at you. You're 16. You feel like a chooch. Like, it's just, it's unbelievable. Yeah. I don't know. I think those stories are just prime.
There's some fun stuff like that, yeah. You know what? As a rookie, you know, being a young rookie, that's one thing. But I was a little different, you know. I went to that prep experience. So when I got to junior, I was a 19-year-old rookie.
Yeah, you were.
And I remember, you know, going to our rookie party because we had a rookie party back then. And, you know, it wasn't... You know, it wasn't one of those rookie parties where it's like hazing or nothing like that. There was events where if guys wanted to do it, you did it. If you want to participate as a rookie, and I'm a 19-year-old guy, like I don't have to be, you know, hazed or embarrassed, and I decide to, you know, have fun and participate in the games. That's one thing, right? Like if the guys put on a party for the rookies to have some fun and, you know, in a safe environment, that's one thing. You know, of course, we don't, no one promotes underage drinking or nothing like that. And if, you know, whatever happens there happens, but, you know, the older guys were making sure that stuff was on the up and up, so
always,
you know, it was lots of fun.
Always.
Yeah, it is a lot of fun. I think hazing, I don't really see it as that, but there is instances where it is hazing, but in my experience it's just been all fun.
Yeah,
you know, being a rookie's a good time. Like I enjoyed it.
So you're never gonna be like a rookie twice on that team, you know what I mean? Like so like, and like when I was a rookie I had the best vets I could ever ask for. They took care of you, you know what I mean, whatever. And like, but they made you earn your stripes a little bit, and I think that's just a part of the game growing up.
And it just makes it that more fun when you're the older guy.
Yeah,
too.
When it's to a point, you know what I mean? Like it's just, and like you have
I think if things are inclusive, that's good. If things alienate people, that's the danger of it, right? That's where it becomes hazing. But if things are inclusive, where guys are having fun with each other, I think that's okay. And
100%.
We would get guys, we would like kind of wet some guys like socks and underwear.
Oh, yeah.
Fill
a guy's
freezer.
You ever fill a guy's stick up with water?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. You pop the top, fill it with water. Yeah. Oh, that was prime.
Yeah, you're not hurting anybody with that, and it's like, okay, guys, you got me. Like I can put another pair of socks on. You know, it doesn't hurt nobody. That's funny, and you get a laugh out of it, and it's like, okay, a couple rookie jokes, and then the rookie jobs. I think I always thought that was, you know, kind of more important rather than, you know, having jokes with people. It's like, you know, pack the bus, do stuff like that. Some guys take advantage and say, oh, you know, pack my bag and this and that, and that's a little far, but I think
because they're not gonna say no.
Exactly.
They're gonna say no.
Exactly. And they're taking advantage of that. But you know, I think when guys have their jobs, you know, filling up water bottles, you know, picking
pucks.
Up pucks, stuff like that.
Yeah.
That's just part of the pecking order, man.
That's
part of it.
But you know, unloading and unloading the bus, I think that's something, you know what I mean? Like packing gear, touching somebody else's kind of wet gear is a little iffy. It's a lot iffy for me.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, you know, as a rookie, take the bags off the bus.
Yeah.
Would you?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's not a big deal.
No.
It's 1 year.
And don't go near the back of the bus. All right? No, I'm just playing around. But obviously, like, anyways, any good bus stories? Like, you used to own the back of the bus? Like, what was the thing?
I was pretty far back. Yeah, we'd have some good times, sometimes throwing food up at the rookies.
Oh, yeah. Let them know.
Oh, yeah.
Let them know they're rookies still.
We had some long bus trips, too, from Erie, traveling all around Ontario. So we spent a lot of time on the bus. We'd get blackjack going, buy in with, like, 20 chips and play. And
Nice. Keep the young kids up front and the older boys get back there. Yeah, for sure.
There's always like the young kids wait, like trying to hop in when there's an open spot.
No chance.
No
chance.
They got a long line, but
yeah,
it's a good time. A lot of blackjack on the bus, a lot of cards, just trying to pass the time.
Yeah, absolutely.
What was your travel like out in Austria?
It was all bus. We had trips to like Slovenia.
Nice.
I had like 3 trips there. I only played 4 games, but the only trips we had were to there. Yeah.
Couple reps. Yeah, how did it feel bearing your first one out there? What was it like?
It was nice. It was in my first game.
Of course it was.
I was breakaway and I just went to my go-to move and
Was one by the goalie's ear?
No. No, it was kind of low glove, I guess.
Low glove, yeah.
Yeah, just a quick snapper.
There you go. Got to have the quick release.
Yeah.
Let's catch them by surprise.
Yeah, why not?
Man. So you're saying you went to Slovenia, so those bus trips, what's that like? You know, the language, are those guys good at English? Because I know that gets a little interesting sometimes. Yeah. I remember being on the bus and I'm hearing guys and talk about stuff, and I think I know what the hell they're talking about because I'm trying to, like, you know, zone in, but I don't. And what was that like? You know?
Yeah, they pretty much, I think everybody spoke English, actually.
What is that first language out in Austria?
It's German.
It's German? German, oh, I didn't know that. But you were, sorry to cut you off, most people spoke English there?
I would say 80% of people, and the ones that didn't, they understood like the basics kind of, but I would say almost everyone.
Yeah, that was pretty good. Honestly, same thing when I was out in Denmark and Sweden. Yeah, like, most people spoke English. It was just funny, like, to hear the little side conversations, obviously, when they in the comfort zone, you know, because they're not trying to be rude, but they're just talking in their language. Trying to communicate with people, I didn't find difficult, but it was just interesting to sometimes hear the conversations. And the coach, actually, when I was in Denmark, interesting thing, he'd always come in and look at us 3 English guys, because we'd sit there as me, my buddy Tyler, and my other buddy Nikita, and he'd be like, okay, I take it to Danish. We're like, okay. And then he'd just like do the speech in Danish or whatever.
Yeah, that's crazy.
And then after he'd come and just like kind of tell us, break it down for us, because obviously it's tough for him, right, to say the whole thing in English. But did you have an English-speaking coach out there?
Yeah, so for the second team, the coach was Canadian. He played in Owen Sound, actually.
Come on.
Yeah, so
that's pretty cool.
So that was, yeah, that's pretty cool.
What's his name?
And then, Kirk Fury.
Kirk Fury.
Yeah.
Right on. So do you have a good career in Owen Sound?
Yeah, he was good. And then he's been coaching over there, I think, for a few years now. But yeah, he spoke English, and I think on that team I might have been the only guy that their first language was English, so they might have been speaking like just full Austrian until I got there and switched everything over. I don't really know. But.
That's pretty cool. So is that how you got over there then, through that connection? Like, you knew him, or was it like through your dad?
No,
your
my dad also played, yeah, right? my dad played pro in Austria, actually, for the same team for a
so
little
did,
bit.
So did you, were you born there?
No, I was born here.
You were born here, Canada. But did you go to Austria at all as a kid? Or
no, I never went as a kid. But my dad, he just has always had his citizenship and passport.
That's
and that
awesome.
Kind of thing. So
huge advantage.
Yeah, when we actually, funny story, we met up with a guy that he played with, his brother back in the day, ended up being Marco Rossi, his agent. So then they started talking, and then they kind of figured some stuff out and sped up the process a bit, and then I ended up getting my passport and citizenship.
Oh, wow.
Already,
that's
so
huge.
That's unbelievable.
So
that's,
now I'm a dual awesome. Citizen of Austria and Canada. So
yeah, well, that's great to have that advantage, obviously, with your dad, right, and that connection to have somebody help speed up the process, because other people get on waiting lists and it's really hard to get your citizenship, and it can be tough, and that's just awesome, man, to have dual citizenship moving forward, and that makes sense to you, having the 2-year contract and all that.
Yeah.
So that's exciting, man.
Yeah,
you
for
know,
sure.
You can really have a nice career over there. That's a great league, and that's exciting. I'm happy for you.
Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm.
We got to hear some of those tilt stories. You know, both of you guys, how many fights would you say you've been in the OHL each? We got to hear some of them.
OHL, I'd say, I'm thinking like 14 probably.
That's a lot.
That's not a little bit of fights.
12 yeah. to 14.
That's not a few.
That's a good amount.
Daisy? How about you, Dave? 12. I think 12 for me.
Oh yeah, eh?
We got
a couple dobs, eh? Who now like let's go here. You guys are playing in your 19-year-old year. You guys are both playing in the O here, okay? Last year. Who's got the belt? Who's the heavy between you two right now?
I don't know. We've almost won once before.
You guys almost fought each other?
Yeah.
Let's hear it. What happened?
Well, it was his buddy Drysdale is in front of him. I just hit him, was kind of going at it with him, and he was a 16-year-old. I think I was like 18 at the time. And obviously, Kurt had to come in. He's seen my name, right? And he just comes flying.
Did he have the heavy left shoulder? Big A on the jersey? No, left shoulder?
Not that.
No, but then, yeah, we kind of, he's like, let's go, bud. And I just looked at him and shook my head. I'm like, I can't fight you, man.
Oh, you could have. I fought a couple of my buddies.
I don't think I could hit him. Sure. Like, actually, to hurt him, I don't think.
That's brotherly love.
That is brotherly love. Until he hits you hard, then.
Yeah.
Back, yeah, if he throws one in your chops, you're thinking a little different after that.
Easily, yeah. you're not thinking the same.
But who's throwing the first one? There you go.
Yeah,
it's the respect thing, right? Who's going to hit him first? That's unreal.
Yeah.
Okay, so actually, toughest guy you ever fought? We got to hear both of you guys. You had 12 fights each. That's a lot. What's the memorable one? Who caught you? Like, who'd you beat up? We got to hear
it. I'd say mine is I fought this kid on Sudbury. So my first year, we traded for this kid from Sudbury, and he was, like, talking to some of the guys before the game because he knew the boys on Sudbury. And I guess one of the guys on the team was like, hey, who will fight me tonight? I need a fight. And he's like, Henry will fight you. So then buddy comes to the room, tells me, like, hey, like, 11 might go. Yeah, like, he's said he's looking for a fight tonight. I said you'd probably go him. I was like, yeah, like, I'll probably go him if you ask. So then we're in a draw in the defensive zone, and then he's like, hey, let's go. So I'm like, all right, let's go. So we square up and fight, and it was like a 50-second long fight, just throwing punches the whole time. He caught me a couple times good, but the guy on my team told me he was on steroids in the summer.
Oh my god.
This kid was admitting.
So you're fighting a horse.
Yeah.
So, guy's on the gas, eh?
And the guy was admitting it to him before that he was on steroids. So this guy was just a nail gun. He was unreal fight. You guys got to watch it.
Yeah, we'll get it. We'll post it up.
I get clocked a couple times.
We'll post that one up.
Yeah, we're going to post
we'll
that post fight.
We'll get one of Daisy's too. We'll kind of throw a little
yeah,
in there.
Yeah, we're going to make a good video.
Let's see. What were your heavy tilt? Let's go. Any battles?
Yeah, there was one. It was my rookie year, and he was a 20-year-old, Zach Shankar. He's actually kind of my buddy now. Like, we played PS4 sometimes. But I was coming out to block a shot. Hits me like right above my shin pad on my knee, so I fall. I can barely like skate to the bench. I'm like, fuck, like my leg's killing me, can barely skate. So then Borky defense coming up the left side, and he just gets absolutely lit up by the off D, like lit up in his head. He had ended up being like a major like suspension too, but I'm like, I gotta go. Like, I can barely skate, but I gotta go.
I love it.
So I just drop my gloves, and he's an OA at the time. Like, it's his last year, and I'm a rookie. I'm like, I gotta go. I drop my gloves, just kind of, I just grab them, and I'm like, all right.
As
I'm
a
going.
Rookie, he has a responsibility to go.
Can't even walk. Put a chalk it up on the block shot column. Yeah. Can't even stand up on his blades.
He's going. Yeah. 16.
I need it.
Love it.
It was good though.
Standing like, up for the boys.
Yeah. I connected with a lot. He had a pretty good black eye after. Nice. I seen him at the bus, was talking to him, but
you don't feel it till after though.
Yeah, no, you don't even hear anything during the. Like, I think I've been in probably about 17 to 20 tilts in my career, and it was a little different when I played before. You know, it was a little rough, but you don't hear nothing.
No.
Like, you don't. You get into that as soon as the gloves come off.
Yeah,
it's you got you tunnel
and
vision.
It's you and that guy, and then. But soon as that fight's over, the crowd's going nuts. Oh, yeah. Oh my god, you get the chills.
Oh yeah.
And then maybe the night off, your hands feel, your head feel a little bit.
The only thing in your mind's like, I'm not losing.
Right? I'm not losing.
Yeah.
I'm not losing
to this guy in front of this many people. Like,
I'm not losing.
Yeah.
Not losing. Hit me as much as you want. I'm not losing. You can hit. I love getting hit too. It's kind of.
Oh yeah. Honestly, for me, I got about like maybe two or three. I got very few fight stories.
Yeah, not about me, but
I had one good one though. This is it was in Denmark. And weird place because, like, I played in Canada my whole life and never had a squared up, like, toe-to-toe drop and go. So I had, like, scrums and stuff where, like, gloves come off, whatever, like, in piles, shit like that. But the first ever, like, square up toe-to-toe I had was in Denmark against a Canadian guy named Kyle Heffernan. And what happened was, so first game we played as against Jutland Vikings, and this guy, he like kind of speared me by the bench. So I was like, what the fuck? Like, lost my mind. I was like, go me, buddy, go me. He goes, you got to earn it. So now I'm pissed, and I'm like, this guy just like shrugged me off. Like, who's he think he is? Whatever. So now the rest of the season, I'm like, every time we play him, I'm gunning for this guy. Yeah. Like, I want him bad. So it was like the fourth or fifth time we played him, and I kind of like iced the puck, and he goes back and curls it up. They had an empty net, and I catch him curling up the ice, open ice, and I kind of bury him. And he loses footing, and he gets up, puck goes in the corner, and he comes to hit me, and I drop my shoulder into him again, just like as he's coming towards me, and I hit him, and right in his face, I'm like, woo! Like, right, gave him one of those, and he goes, let's go. So I'm like, all right. I earned it. Let's go.
They gave him Ric Flair and earned it, eh?
Yeah, so we dropped him, and, you know, I was like, okay, here we go. This guy was big, too, and here you go. He's shaking off his elbow pads. He's setting up, and in my head, I'm like, I'm fucked. Yeah. Like, I was like, I'm about to get killed. Like, I've never squared up with a guy in my life. So I'm like, okay, whatever, like, going in. So I grab him, and I kind of miss, but I grab him like on the wrong side, so now I'm just trying to throw over top, like threw four or five, whatever, and start losing my footing. I was a little gassed too, threw a couple of hits, and so I grabbed him and just tried to like pull him down towards the ice, and so we fall and turned over, and he gets on top of me, and he starts like hammer fisting the back of my head like this. Like, did you ever see like Semin when he's fighting?
Yeah, that's what it looked like.
Yeah,
oh my
I was
God.
Like, oh, this is embarrassing. That's literally my one good story.
That's your one good tilt, eh?
That's it.
Wouldn't go me 2 years.
I know. I'm not going you. Are you kidding
me? That's a funny one. Well, yeah, but I wasted a lot of time flying around. A lot of energy flying around the ice. You were fast. You know what I mean? Like, I couldn't catch you.
Yeah, Scoot wouldn't let me go.
Scoot.
He did not want me to go. Yeah, the one time, actually, this is another one, too. It's kind of funny, but we were playing Caledonia, and Connor Murphy, this guy who was like highly touted, supposed to go.
He's a dynamite player,
man.
He
was on the NHL draft list.
He's a stud, dude.
Yeah, and I didn't even really know it was him, but I was going to the net, kind of chasing the guy to the net. It happened to be him, and I put his head like into the post, not on purpose, but just how it happened. And his dad was up standing up behind. My dad had vertigo at the time, so he wasn't on the bench. I got kicked from the game, and you know, we're standing up there, and Murphy's dad's losing his mind. And Tony Passero, God bless his soul, he was alive at the time. And they start beaking each other, whatever, and this fight starts. And Kyle Marino fought a guy, he gets kicked out. So now we're in the stands, in our gear. Anthony Passero, who was out with the concussions, like, they're all fighting behind, like, the, you know where they stand in Fort Erie there, where the doors are?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So everyone's fighting there. We're, like, up there in our gear. Like,
no way. You guys are battling?
Yeah, wow. It was wild. And Anthony Passero ripped the guy's sleeve off his jacket, and he was carrying it like this.
No way. The awesome. Metrodome, eh?
Yeah, it was
the
funny.
Fort Erie.
That's how I remembered it. But
that's
anyways,
great.
Yeah.
Oh, I had just a few battles. Mm-hmm. And you know what, though? I think, and like, I know it's kind of a rough topic. It's kind of on and off, but like, How do you remove that from the game?
Oh, I'll get you going. And you guys, I'm sure, too, had to see some good ones. Game? Like, even from other guys, like, not even yourselves. You guys had to see some toe-to-toe just battles.
Yeah, it's unreal to watch, too. Gets the boys fired up. But
I remember Jacob Friend, one of my good buddies still, he fought Michael Pizzetta, and it was the most, like, crazy fight I've ever seen. Like, it looked like it was the 80s. Like, it was nuts.
You need it.
It was
you
nuts. Need it. He was telling the refs to get out, and they wanted to break it up after, like, a minute. It was crazy.
That's awesome. Kind of love that.
You know, I got a good one for you guys. Okay, going into your mind image of year, all right? So, how's it all lead up? How's it all feel leading up to that draft day? Like, what do you guys do? How do you guys prepare? Like, what put you guys in that...
Yeah, like, you know,
in that realm to be like, you know what, I'm getting drafted. Like, when did you find out you were getting, like, you know your spot in the draft? And, like, how did you, like, set yourself up to get ready to go for
that?
And
mentally, for these guys, like, young guys that might be listening, like, how do you prepare yourself mentally for that draft? And just, you know, even the development in the next year, you guys both played did you play in Fort Erie for a year?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you guys both played a year of development before you moved up, right? Yeah. Tell us a little about that experience, and these guys, you know, coming up, getting ready on your way out of the O, these guys getting ready to enter the O. Tell them about that, like, how they should go about that.
Yeah, it's a ton of fun, minor midget. It was a great year. Thinking back to it, we had a lot of great times in that year. So you kind of take it for granted because, you know, after you get drafted and then you go to an OHL team, like, it's all business there. Like, they just want the best team. Like, when I went into it, there was like the Brinkett Strom, they were all there still.
Oh my
so
god.
It was pretty intimidating, but you're separated into three different teams too, so you do fitness testing and then you just kind of hang out in the room, get ready before the game, and you're in like the room with like half the Erie team, like just this gross team all in there, and they're only talking to each other, and like
there's like
let's say seven of them in the room, and then 13 other schmelts rookies just coming to try out.
Yeah.
So they're just like them seven just talking to each other. Then they say the odd thing to a rookie, but all the rookies are just quiet sitting there, like don't know each
and
other.
And you don't know whether to chime in or not.
Yeah, it's just crazy to think that you were the kid, like not really talking, the shy kid, like looking at McDavid and DeBrinket and whatever.
Yeah, it's intense.
And then now being the 20-year-olds, there's kids looking at us like that and saying, oh, I wish I was them. Like, But I would do anything to go back and. And, yeah, like, I didn't take it for granted, but I didn't realize how fast it would go by.
You never do.
It zips by. I think we talked about it last episode, too. Yeah. I've been told all the time, people, they tell you, don't let it fly by, and you know what it does.
Yeah.
It does, and you, it's always going to fly by. But you look back, those memories.
Just take advantage of every experience.
Oh, my God. But, you know, you look back, you made memories no matter what.
Yeah,
like 100%. You made some, your every best day. Friends, mm-hmm. some, like the best people you meet are around that time, right? So.
Yeah,
I remember. Junior hockey's the best.
Ethan Zapula, I remember my first year. He's one of my best buddies on the team that I played with in Owen Sound. And he said to me, he's like, yeah, you know, just enjoy it. It's a quick 5 years. And I'm thinking, oh, I'm 16. Yeah. 5 years. This guy's 21. Like, are you kidding me?
And now, been around forever.
And now I'm sitting here turning 21 in 2 months.
Yeah.
Like, it's nuts. Like, I thought it would never end. And
yeah, dude.
It's crazy how quick it goes.
Yeah, the reality of, like, just time and what it is. You know, it doesn't hit you because as a kid, too, and it's so exciting. And anything, any junior hockey experience, any hockey experience. I went away to school and, you know, it's exciting and it's experience. And you think, like, oh, next year's going to be awesome. Next year's going to be awesome. Next year's going to be awesome. And now it's like, okay, I'm 21. Next year's going to be awesome. Next year, what's going to be next year? Yeah. You know, like, So then it gets real very fast.
Yeah.
Because guys don't realize just, like, the opportunities and, they get very small after beyond junior hockey. You know, there's a lot of junior hockey to be played. You know, the few guys that are very good move beyond there, and there's limited spots even beyond there, right? You're part of a very elite group, really, that gets to play junior hockey, and on top of that, in the CHL, both you guys, and you know, you're such talented young guys, and you know, it's just unreal. It's unreal to have the local talent like we do in Niagara, and to have in this league. You know, like we talk about junior hockey, and we want to talk about junior hockey a lot in this podcast. And what was that even like for you guys as 16-year-olds playing the Goje, you know, preparing you for the OHL?
Yeah, it was, I think that was my first step to being where I am today. Tony Passero and the Passero family has obviously been really close with my family growing up and my whole life, and being able to play for him and developing, he really gave me the ice time that I feel like I deserved, and he
since you were 12 and 13.
Seriously, this guy's burying on goals.
Just a quick side note, stay where you are, but quick side note, I think I mentioned it earlier, but 12 or 13 years old, this guy's coming out when I'm 19, 20, and he's burying on our goalies, and I'm getting pissed off in the corner because I'm like, who the hell is this guy? I think he is. He's 12 years old. Anyways, just awesome to see. But yeah, Tony was like that. He'd let the local guys take advantage of that ice time, like you're saying. So
And then coming out, obviously playing there, I was 16. I played a lot as a 16-year-old, which doesn't happen often, and I produced well, and I took advantage of the ice time I got, obviously, and the opportunity I was given. And I ended up having a good start to the season, and that's when I signed my contract with Owen Sound. Awesome. And then I was kind of up and down my first year with Fort Erie and Owen Sound, and then after that I was full-time up with them, so...
That's great.
But I wouldn't have been there if I went to a team like, say, St. Catharines or Caledonia, where I wouldn't have played and got the opportunity of actually developing.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's a big thing for Fort Erie. They actually care about developing their players.
Yeah, giving guys the opportunity.
And giving them. And that's the biggest thing. If you play 30 minutes a night, like, you're going to do good.
Yeah.
You have a way better chance of doing good the more you play. And if you earn that time, you're going to do good.
Yeah, you got to earn
that. Exactly.
And that's that, and if you're given the opportunity and you earn it, then
it's great.
See what happens.
similar to Kurt's experience.
Kurt, so let's move along to you here with your first year. Listen, you played, I played on the Canucks for 4 years. Listen, like the Canucks, that logo is to die for. You know, you kind of just missed out on that logo, and it's a little disappointing. But you know, at the end of the day, Frankie Pietrangelo, he's done a great job so far there, and I respect what he's doing there. You know, he's built a great team, great organization. He's taken it to another level. But I played for the old logo, the old team, and it was a dynamite. But you know what? That just the organization itself is just so historical, so legendary. How did it feel to kind of throw that sweater on your first year as a 16-year-old hometown kid?
Yeah, it's awesome. You always go to the Junior B games growing up, right?
Oh, so yeah.
You grow up watching them, so you always have that dream, a plan for them at some point. So after minor midget, after I got drafted, it was perfect to go there for a year of development and then try and go to make Erie after that. But it was awesome playing for the Canucks every night, Friday night. It was awesome, but great memories there. And then
you took my uncle, eh?
Yeah, I did.
My uncle Greg coached there when Kurt was
there.
He said he loved them.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah. And you and you easily got the time. You earned your time there, and they gave you the time to kind of develop too.
That's the thing. Like, we had a pretty good team too that we competed, but yeah, I got good ice time there. I played a lot. They did a good job developing me. I got good opportunities, so it was awesome. But then the thing is, the next year when you go play major junior, it's not as guaranteed your ice time, right? You got to battle it out in practice. Yep. So the Canucks, you kind of had your spot, but then when you move on to the higher ranks, it's like you got to earn it every day in practice, in the weight room, or mm-hmm. you're not going to be playing, you'll be in the stands.
That's the biggest difference between like junior hockey and minor hockey. Like, you could be the best player in the league, but if you're the worst player on the ice in practice all week, you're not playing.
It doesn't
matter who you are, like, you're not playing if you're terrible.
Yeah, and they're there to produce professionals, right? Like, that's their development league, and that's why they're the best in the world. Honestly, the CHL, I would say, you know, the Dub, the OHL, the Q, they do it right because those guys, they're challenging their guys every day, right? They're not letting them get complacent. They're not letting guys fall under that umbrella of, you know, just laziness and complacency. Yeah. They're challenging you guys and you know, force you to compete in practice, and that's awesome to hear that is the case, you know, from you guys firsthand. So, you know, great to hear that the OHL is doing a great job.
And they like they were saying too, like, it's clear, like, they hold you so accountable within the off season. If you don't show up to camp ready to go, you ain't there. Yeah. You're gone. Mm-hmm. You're done. You ain't even signing a contract. You're done. You're out of there.
You got young kids coming in every year, high draft picks coming in, trying to make the team, working hard. Like, if you're not gonna work hard, they will. So you gotta earn it.
Exactly. And you know what? I think a lot of guys too think, you know, once I'm there, I'm there, right? Like, I'm here, I'm in the OHL, and they don't realize, hey, there's how many rounds there? 15?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's 15 guys getting drafted, plus walk-ons, plus the guys from the year before that got drafted that are almost ready.
Mm-hmm.
They don't realize the limited availability and the amount of guys competing for those positions, right? It's so, you got to stay on your game. You got to stay at it. It's so important.
Yep. Okay, so boys, you know, I got to kind of break it down for the kids a bit here because, you know, that's a big part of our show too, right? Like, we want to hit every kind of level of hockey. Going into your draft year, like, you're young. What, even going into your, every year, going past your draft year too, that off season, that work ethic, it kind of, like, how was it for you guys? What did you guys do to kind of keep not even physically in shape, but mentally in shape too? Because if you're not there, you're not.
Yeah. Not on the team. Well, they say, you know, you can only get this. Let's talk about pro hockey and the line, right? It's paper thin. You know, pro hockey players are pro hockey players. They're great. 90% of the game's mental, right? So you got to learn that growing up, and like Vito's talking about here. So how do you prepare yourselves?
Yeah, I just feel like, I feel for me, honestly, it's a little bit different than maybe a lot of people. But I feel like I just got to, when I get to the rink, I just want to be myself. I don't want to not talk to anybody and just be quiet and not myself, because if I'm not being myself I'm not gonna play good. I feel like if I'm going kind of shooting the shit with guys, just being a little bit loose, like, not messing around obviously, but just being loose, like
that relaxed intensity.
I just go into it like it's another game. I've been doing this my whole life, and I know what I gotta do. Let's just
hockey's fun.
Yeah,
that's it. And that's not a bad way to look at anything at all. Kurt,
I feel like, too, going back to what Vito said, I feel like you gotta wanna do it, and if you don't put the effort in, you're never gonna make it.
Never.
If you don't want it, you won't make it.
To shorten it up, like, if you're not working as hard as you can in the weight room and as hard as you can in practice on the ice, you're not making it.
No. Yeah.
You're not.
Yeah, like growing up, there's so many kids out there who are trying to get drafted and stuff. So if you're not working hard every day and, you know, having fun with it, though, minor midget's a fun year. Minor hockey's a great time.
Have a good time. Like, you
just
know,
enjoy the time there, because before you know it, you're done and you're on to junior hockey, and then before you know it, that's done. So I'd just say, like, enjoy every day, work hard. If you want, you got to go for it. You got to work hard.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like, too, a lot of people underestimate, well, a lot of players that are playing underestimate how many people are fighting for their spot. And there's millions of kids that would die to be where they are. And all it takes is a bad attitude or a couple bad practices, and you could be, there could be 10 guys ahead of you.
And that's something I really noticed with you guys, especially, like I said, like we've been on the ponds and whatnot, and we always have good attitudes, but it's the pond. But actually coming out through this podcast and through talking to you guys, the attitudes you guys come out with are just unbelievable. It's just very upbeat, but very professionally knowing what you got to do on and off the ice throughout the hockey world.
Yeah, because it's not over for you guys, right?
No. Yeah. You know, and this is our only training, too, really.
Yeah, exactly.
You know? But it's just you guys are very, very, very genuine people, very gentlemanlike, and you guys, work ethic sounds unbelievable. I know it's unbelievable.
Yeah, and it's going to continue, right? Like, you know, you got your contract, and Kurt, you got great things ahead of you. So, you know, thanks, guys, so much for coming on, honestly. I don't know.
Man, I had this was a blast.
Yeah.
I had such a fun time tonight.
Yeah, we were excited to talk to you guys. And honestly, like I said, for me, it's funny just to watch you growing up and see your development from a young kid. And Kurt, you know, I didn't know nothing about you until that one time, like I said, that reminded me. I seen you play, and funny enough, I'm friends with your sister. But you know, to see you play that one time, and it's wild to be sitting here with you guys at the end of your OHL careers and see where you've come. It's awesome.
Oh, it's unbelievable. Just to see, like you don't see kids work the way these kids do. You know what I mean? And it's just great to see you going forward the way they represent Niagara Falls and Fort Erie very well. And I was glad to have you guys tonight. It was honestly an honor to have you guys. And I hope you guys have you guys back.
Yeah, thanks a lot for having us, and I'm sure we'll see you guys tomorrow at the pond.
Yeah, we're going tomorrow, yeah. Awesome, boys. If we can get like we did on the first episode, I think we're going to carry it on for this episode, too. We're going to give a little salute.
Add
the cheers, boys. Thanks for coming on. Have a great night.
Thanks, boys.
Thanks, boys.
All right, kid. So, what'd you think?
Man, it just gets better and better, doesn't it?
Yeah, honestly, it was nice. It was nice having those young guys on. It's cool to, you know, just talk to those younger minds and hear their perspective sometimes, because they're still going through it, right? You know, they've had their experiences, you know, the few of them, and there's going to be many more. So it's exciting to see those guys just, you know, still chasing the dream, and it's awesome, and at a high level.
Yeah, absolutely. Just to hear the stories they have and this, like, just to hear how much they've accomplished in such little time, and how dedicated these kids are and how professional they are at such a young age. It's just incredible to see. And it just shows how much the hockey world's starting to come along, how far it's come almost, right?
Yeah, firsthand with the development of these kids, firsthand to watch them, you know, from 14 years old, 15 years old, see them, and we're on the pond with them, and they're making us look silly out there.
Oh, it's incredible.
It's great. And you know what? I hate to say that I love it, but I love when they make us look silly, because it's great to see these young guys come out of our region.
You know, like, you think as you get older, you're going to teach a lot, but you know, you learn a lot, too, and just being on the pond with these kids, I learned a lot. Just even talking to them, I've learned a lot tonight, and, you know, it was stellar having these kids on. I had a great time tonight.
That's why we're doing this.
Yeah, that's absolutely right, and I hope everyone else out there enjoys it, and, if you have anything to say, don't be scared to shoot us a message on. We're on Instagram right now. We're also on Spotify, YouTube, and I believe we're going to be on Apple Music coming up this week, correct?
Yeah, next couple of days. Keep an eye out. We'll be on Apple. But we appreciate all the support so far, guys. Really, you know, it's been great reach out so far from you guys, and you know, just unbelievably appreciative. We've done this for fun to start out here, and you know, great feedback, and we're excited to continue.
Absolutely, guys. Thank you very much for tuning in, and be ready for the next ones coming up. We got some gems coming your way as always, as promised. And you guys have a great night.
Yeah, we'll see you soon.
Yeah, take care, guys.